this is John Cole with GrowingYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. In this episode, we're going to do like a rant-style video with Josh and me about the favorite topic at hand. You know, I've been seeing some comments that like, dude, you're such a stoner, and they're talking about me, not Josh. You know, they're also saying, why are you advocating for cannabis now? You know, I watch your channel with kids. And so I really want to take a video out of, you know, all the videos I do to share my thoughts for you guys about my thoughts and cannabis specifically, since I know there is some confusion out there, and I got Josh to basically back me up. He's a big cannabis advocate, such as I am, but we're kind of different kind of cannabis advocates personally. So the first question for Josh, am I a stoner? Have you ever seen me get high?
Never.
Never? I don't know.
Wait,
you
wait,
did.
No, there
you
was
did.
One night, allow me to amend, when I then became a willing guinea pig of a juice recipe that he had accidentally ingested, which, as it turned out, was a very effective juice recipe. And John asked me, what is the worst thing that could ever happen to John Kohler? I thought, my God, you know, family member die, girlfriend dump you, what's up, bro? Dude, I got stoned. I was like, oh, that sounds great. Why, you know, what a great problem to have. And that was in the evening, and you complained how you were focused and then hyper-focused, and you were so ADHD, you were some crazy, what sounds to me, blissed out ADHD in your work zone in the garden all day. That was an amazing, John Lennon wrote that song, Life is What Happens to Us While We're Busy Making Other Plans. John was just busy making plans to get a productive day done in this garden. What was this, 2015?
It was years ago. I mean, we got the video down below. You can see how I got high for 10 hours on
my rabbit canvas. Ate the same leaves. Now, these were from the
indoor MIT.
These were MIT's leaves. Now, you'd already been juicing those like several months prior.
Yeah, I've been juicing
several
those
visits,
a bunch.
Right? I had kept them in my freezer at Leah's expense.
Fridge.
And freezer.
No, I didn't use the freezer ones.
You messed up. Keeps it raw. Anyway, for juicing and getting good energy from the juice, and of course, the laws of wisdom of all edible THC decarboxylation and psychoactive properties are that one has to cook cannabis, ideally in a carrier oil, what's typically used for deliberate oil recipes, MCT oil, which would be a coconut oil, very stable oil to cook anything with. But this was raw. I mean, this guy's raw, okay? So, yeah, it was wild, that episode, and the part, it's after 420, and I've already enjoyed my Storz & Bickel portable vaporizer, so forgive me for looking a bit distracted, but I'm recollecting it all, and it was an amazing chain of events, because I woke up, I agreed, didn't you do a pre-episode where you said, okay, you're agreeing to not do your wake and bake other Storz & Bickel, with my workhorse volcano machine, right? And I willingly did not do a wake and bake. Three reasons the business is small: BBC, bicycling, BSing, and cannabis. Just being honest. So, anyways, not my normal wake and bake, and his recipe. And my God,
it worked.
It didn't just work. It was possibly, John, I kid you not, the greatest high of all time.
It was the worst high for all times. For me, I tried another worse one, actually, more worse than that, but
so
that was a long-lasting high I could not get rid of and it did not wear off.
So typically, weed is my speed, right? I'm a nervous, skinny, adrenal constitution, selfish athlete, bicycling type, get in motion, keep that brain out of commotion, get out there and enjoy a sativa buzz, and most of the herb we consume. Stoners, it will be a blend of indica and sativa. So anyway, at 420, late to the video with you, I promise you by 4, I consumed indica 100%, and thus am feeling, you know, couch lock right now. As I do this video with you, I'm not sure about my rant abilities right now even, which is great, but most weed actually really gets me going. But my point about that juice recipe, and I forget what variant it was. Do you remember the variety?
Yeah, it was tangerine, coconut, and cannabis.
No, but what variety was the cannabis?
Oh, I don't remember that, man. MIT just gave
what
me
his
trim.
What was he growing at the time? Was he growing any indica at the time? Anyway, it was definitely a sativa because the energy, the creativity, and the physical, that whole, what I just described, it would have been the ideal recipe to go do a familiar bike ride. You know, I don't advocate riding all effed up on anything. Of course, ride, you know, I want to be as safe as possible and live to ride my bike tomorrow. But as cyclists are want to do, especially the gravel and mountain biking variant of us, we love our safety sessions, which involve the healthiest forms of cannabis consumption, from gummies to portable convection and conduction heat, Storz and Bickel, little micro mighty, you know, vaporizers and so on. But this high from that juice recipe was almost too good to be true. And you know what? I'll be honest, I'm not going to lie, I have not recreated that recipe. Maybe I have to have a chat with my self-esteem and you know, do the whole guinea pig routine with the identical recipe. Yeah, describe the recipe again.
I mean, I have a video on it where I show how to make it because I was going to show everybody how you could ingest cannabis without getting high, and then it got me high. So, I mean, it was basically I blended up, I think it was coconut water with coconut meat mature.
With the pith.
Yeah.
Everything apart from the husk itself.
And the shell, yeah. Uh-huh. Blend that up and then I pour.
With what device?
With just a blender. With
a high
power blender.
Vitamix.
Yeah, Vitamix.
Which uses some heat.
No, it didn't get that hot. I didn't run it that long.
It must have warmed the fatty acids up a bit.
No, because I didn't. At that point, I didn't even. There was no cannabis involved. So then after that, I poured that into the juicer. At the same time, I fed in tangerines and the cannabis leaves.
So the leaf at all times never experienced heat.
I would say yes. I mean, maybe you got some crushing ability, and the juicer can raise the temperature of something like 3 degrees, which is nothing.
But the coconut stuff, I'm disputing its heat abilities, because to whip that into the cream you created takes a lot of heat.
Yeah, no.
By the time the cannabis had contacted those fatty acid, whatever, super MCT, it's pretty damn raw, right?
Yeah.
He knows how to do it. He's a pro. He knows how not to inflect that wicked heat. Although now you do some heated foods, correct?
Yeah, I do. So Josh, anyways, getting back to the topic of the video at hand. So you saw me get high once on that drink.
Entirely
accidental.
John Lennon.
I didn't mean to do that.
Right? John Lennon
totally
style,
hated
right?
it. Mm-hmm. And then have you ever seen me smoke, get high, or any? We hang out a lot, and you always got like really good stuff. You're like, I mean, you asked for me to try it rarely, but
no.
I always say no. I've never
eaten it. Well, maybe to taste the bud.
Yeah, I'll eat the bud.
I've got some in my safety sack right now.
No, I won't join
TD from last season. Some of TD's
so
best.
So the point of the matter is, like, would you call me a stoner?
Absolutely not. And it's like, coulda, woulda, shoulda known you when you were one. Pre-health crisis era of your life. Now, let's get real. Before you start playing games and say this is just a game that the best of former frenemies and friends and everything together and our chemistry that you all seem to be entertained by. And I apologize that we interrupt each other so much. We just get so enthused by the topic of each other's conversation. Is that not evidence, you know? The French trust the people who squabble publicly and sort our poop out. And that's what we're just doing, like keeping it real on camera. He is absolutely categorically beyond paranoid of even accidentally getting stoned.
All right. Thank you, Josh. And now I'll say a few other things. So since that time I made that original juice and got high accidentally once.
The one time I've known
in 10 years. I did that a second time with a similar recipe with beets instead of tangerines. But then that time I threw it up. So then it didn't last. So I was like so glad that I threw it up. Actually, I was in the garden and like I threw it up on the ground, and my friend that was working with me, he's like, John, how can you pour your smoothie out? I'm like, that's not a smoothie,
okay,
man.
That's TMI.
Anyways.
That's TMI right there, bro.
That was just gross. Anyways.
Yeah, edit
so
that.
Then, nope, not edit it. And then the next time it happened was I was down in San Diego, and maybe one of my viewers out there in San Diego, I was at a health food store, Ocean Beach Co-op in San Diego. And, like, one of my viewers, like, John, man, I grow good stuff, man. you consume. I'm like, well, I'll eat it. And he's like, he gave me a big fatty bud, dude, like this big. And like, okay, I'm like, okay, if you cook it and heat it and stuff, you could get high, but if you just eat it raw, you can't get high.
You can't get high.
So I was flying back, right? So I was at the airport, at the San Diego airport, and I like ate it with an avocado and artichoke hearts before my flight. I was fine on the flight. Halfway through the flight, I was stoned out of my freaking brain.
What happened?
Like, way bad.
What happened?
I got so high, dude, I couldn't even function. I could just, like, it's gonna be all right. I was, like, really slow motion. I had all these heavy bags that I checked in and had, like, baggage in the overhead that I had to, like, wait for everybody else to get off the plane.
Sounds like the best flight of my
life. Well, you would have been happy as heck. Yeah. I was hating life because I'm like, oh my gosh. I'm, and then they're thinking, I'm getting off in Vegas, and they're like, this guy pre-partied too much.
Seriously?
I was like,
that's how they were reacting to you?
That's what I thought. That's, I mean, I wish I knew, because they like, yeah. And I was really slow, and usually I'm like up and gone.
Right, gone, yeah.
And like, and I was like, I waited till everybody else got off the plane, and I was like in slow motion pulling my baggage off, and I had checked in like two or three bags that were like heavy, full of produce.
And that was from eating a raw bud
with avocado, uh-huh, and artichoke hearts. I don't know. It's anyways,
so the non-juicing version of what happened to you. So we have two recipes,
but I don't know
the unwitting guinea pig, as he's desperately trying to seek the cannabinoid footprint and the superfood benefits of cannabis as a wholesome food. And 99% of the time that you have consumed cannabis since college has been precisely for that purpose, for the purpose of health being our only wealth, and deliberately not getting high. And wouldn't you say that other than those two times, that your consumption of cannabis has been, whenever it can be, when you're blessed enough to come into contact, like here in the 707 Grow Code, the global epicenter of thought leadership for horticultural consciousness, and guys like TD, and so you can juice the leaf to your heart's content. And you don't get high. So most of the time, your consumption of cannabis has been one that's been completely about not getting high. And we have two recipes, one that's liquid and one that's more tertiary, that he can give us with his
sensitive wisdom. Too.
Well, exactly. Well, and now this spleef was not, this was rolled like as if it was to be smoked as a true.
Yeah, as it was a fat bud. People would think I'm crazy for eating a fat bud like that.
And he had rolled it.
Nope. It was just a whole bud.
Okay, just ready to be turned into some sort of, okay.
Exactly.
A whole nice nug. Interesting. With avocado and what else?
Artichoke hearts.
Artichoke. And all raw. And the artichoke was just...
Well, they were previously cooked because they were in a glass jar.
Okay, interesting.
Anyway, so... And then, you know, I would normally consume cannabis for its beneficial, non-intoxicating effects. It's cannabinoids, yep. THCs, plant phytochemicals, vitamins and minerals. It's just like any other herb in my book. It has some special properties in there, of course, you know, for our endocannabinoid system to activate that, you know, our bodies could make some endocannabinoids, and there's some in other foods to much lower extents. But like, I don't want to sacrifice my health and not get all the different plant compounds that are non-poisonous into my body, because there's so much research as cannabis as a neuroprotectant, and cannabis for this, cannabis for that. And many times nowadays I eat hemp, which is also cannabis. It just doesn't contain the THC. This is actually 100%
hemp hat
from Nepal. I love hemp. Hemp is an amazing fiber. And, you know, unfortunately, some people may call it devil's lettuce, and it's been villainized, in my opinion, due to documentaries from a long time ago and through certain, you know, people of religions that have certain beliefs about this plant because of what they are told. You know, I'm kind of just like, this is a plant, you know, and I mean, we should just respect it. I think that children need to know about it. I mean, you would teach your kids about alcohol or, you know, sex. And we should teach our kids about cannabis and how to respect it and be safe with it. So, like, you know, so they're not like me when I was a kid, you know, and like my parents never really told me. And then my friends at high school were like, here, John, try this. And then I was getting high in high school. And then that, you know, got me started in that. Luckily, in high school, I kind of cleaned up a little bit and didn't get that high as much as I should. Then really didn't do it until I started again in college. back in the day, but you know, I'm clean and sober basically. I don't drink alcohol. I don't want to get the intoxicating effects from cannabis, but I want to get the other health benefits from it. So these days I eat CBD or hemp buds. I also get high CBD, low THC buds, and if I eat too big of a flower, I will feel the effects of the intoxication just a little bit. So like if I eat a small little flower, then I'm fine, but if it's too big, then I'm feeling it, and that's not my desired goal. And you know, there are people out there like me that have experienced the benefits from the hemp or CBD style cannabis that is legal in the 50 United States for the most part. And then of course other people could get the effects of the benefits of cannabis without its intoxication if they do it properly, and that's my game, that's my jive, and that's what I choose to do, because I don't like getting high. I'm high on all my green juices and my diet, which I encourage all you guys out there to get high on green juices. I have a channel on YouTube, Discount Juicers, where you could see me make green juice, including hemp juice. I have a video on best juicer for making hemp juice or cannabis juice, if you guys want to do that. And you could drink the juice without getting high in most cases. Actually, that the video I did was actually with hemp cannabis, so there's, you know, basically near zero THC in there. So I did not get high on that. So yeah, that's pretty much the topic of this video. So Josh, like, what are some benefits of cannabis that you believe people should know about and not basically villainize this plant that, yes, can be used improperly, and people below the legal age should not use it, and if it's not legal to use in your state, I don't encourage you guys to break any laws.
I mean, Rick Simpson oil says it all.
Rick Simpson oil, what's that good for, Josh? People may not know what that is.
Rick Simpson oil is the oil that's left over after you've cooked bud, evaporating it safely with pure 100% whatever, you know, organic grain alcohol, and to where there's nothing left but the sticky oil resin. And that cures cancer. I mean, that works where nothing else does, including chemotocracy's inventions. So, I mean, yeah, Rick Simpson oil says it all on the highest level, and that's something that affects 1/3 of us. It's cancer. Hemp has been villainized for far too long. That hat will outlive you. The U.S. Navy to this day, will only use hemp to hold their ships. No man-made chemotocracy-fueled nylon rope will impart nearly the same strength as hemp. I should have worn one of our Caliwana hemp t-shirts. This is some organic cotton one. Hemp is a fabric like no other and can be spun a million different ways and requires the least toxic, can be utilized the most food-grade organic, like indigo style, like that part of Vietnam, Sapa. Well, I'd love Leah to take me back to as society breaks down here in the U.S. So, you know, hemp has just been so misunderstood. And right now, the planet needs it. You know, let's face it, it's the only plant that you can grow in one season that will put triple the oxygen levels per cubic volume liter of CO2 that it absorbs, or in vice versa, consumes triple the CO2 for each liter of oxygen it puts out. Like, you're getting a tree's worth of replenishment of our atmosphere from this plant that can nourish you, that can feed you, that, yes, can get stoners high, that can cure cancer, that can be used for you know, the strongest ropes on earth, fabrics that will outlive the mountains of... Do you know what the number one microplastic in our society is actually from? It's the microfibers that come out of dryer lint.
Yeah, so that's scary when you're using, like, laundry to garden, right?
Shame on us! Shame!
And you have a lot of polyester.
Shame on 80 years of us for allowing man-made fibers to be... Part of the reason each one of us consumes, what is it, 4-6 credit cards a year's worth of plastic, the average human now? Part of the reason you know, that plastic is in that micro particulate coming down. Would it not be that we could just have a solar grid, a sensible grid, and when biodiesel's needed, hemp is there for it too, for God's sakes, and fabrics that were never petrochemical-based to begin with? How do we answer to the next generation? I'm sorry, my sperm count is down by 50% and counting, thanks to microplastics, number one chief culprit.
Well, that's part of it, John.
And we could now imagine if 80 years of hemp fabrics, number one, those they will outlive any of this nylon crap. I've already proven that point with the U.S. Navy only relying on hemp to moor those ships. No nylon rotting in the sun and breaking down in these microparticles coming out of dryer lint, for God's sakes. Shame on us that we haven't already gone full bore and taken every acre and a plant that doesn't ask much for soil biology in return. It's like a super weed on steroids and will actually make a great cover crop in those climates where you want to use it in those off seasons, and on the benefit goes. Just read the book, The Emperor Wears No Clothes, by the great Jack Herrera. Changed my life when I was still a virgin. In 1989, I saw that great man, UC Boulder, no less. Read his book, cover to cover. It's available for free download right now. The best manuscript ever written on the benefits of cannabis and hemp and the disgusting hypocrisy of a chemotocracy hell-bent on disallowing hemp to benefit us. And when did that start, John? Pre-World War II. In the 30s, no less. DuPont had just bankrupted themselves, borrowing money from the Mellon Bank. Andrew Mellon was the head of the U.S. Treasury. Very powerful figure, second or third biggest bank in the country at the time. Had bankrolled DuPont to create the world's first synthetic fiber, believe it or not. Yes, I kid you not. Barely 80 years of synthetic fiber, and it had never been done pre-30s. Now, do you know that around that same time that DuPont, who are just, oh my God, don't get me started with the super funding now today. It needs to be done. The carnage that DuPont 80 years have left is so symbolic of what was inflicted then with the vilification of hemp. Because around that same time that they got that patent for the world's first synthetic fiber, nylon. Oh yes, they did. I swear to God, within a 2-year period of that, a year before or after, don't quote me, it's in the book, The Emperor Wears No Clothes. A combine harvester was invented in the hemp industry that could harvest this commercial hemp, okay, the best fiber crop hemps that we need desperately to literally replenish our atmosphere and provide us with all kinds of biomass that can be used for things like rope and super fibers like t-shirts that last forever and on, right? And so here's DuPont saying, my God, all the cheapest oil ever in humanity, a puddle in Texas at that time, that was cheaper than water, still could not compete with a crop that can be reproduced 2-3 times in one season and produces a stronger fiber yet, and one whose microparticles I could only dream of now existing in our atmosphere every time it rains. So conducted with Andrew Mellon, the vilification. And it was so easy in those pre-fake media, pre-social media, pre-us versus you, all of us fighting it out too, truth of what it all was about. And Congress quietly went along. And suddenly, the farmers that were growing hemp had to pay a hemp tax. Suddenly, they couldn't afford to grow it anymore. And it's in the book, you know, it's all in the book. It's making these farm workers in the South look their bosses in the eyes too much and possibly rape and hurt, you know, whatever, like utter nonsense. Marijuana is very relaxing, even when I claim that it motivates me like your juice recipe did on a bike ride. Nonsense. Utter nonsense. All the reefer madness, I'm living proof of it. Health is our wealth. I choose health over my business. I choose to pedal my bike 10, 15 hours a good week. And I choose not to consume synthetic drugs of any kind. Maybe an organic kombucha, you know, alcoholic once in a blue moon, especially if I'm nervous about getting into going on a camera with John or whatever, having ridden. But the bike riding, you know, that, I mean, that'll never give up, right? I mean, so this thing about addiction, that's nonsense. This, oh, it's a gateway drug. Well, utter crap. I'm living proof that it is not. Because it didn't stop me from staying addicted to something I discovered before puberty at 14, a bicyclist. On a tour with a bunch of hemp-smoking, you know, hippies at the time that formed our tents in the shape of a peace sign. It was the 1980s and the Pershing missile crisis and all this stuff, see? And farmers let us make those peace signs on our sponsored bike ride. And they ate granola and vegan food and introduced me to a band called the Grateful Dead when all I knew at the time at 14 was the police. And so God bless those stoners for showing me, and they didn't get a teenager high, and I rode for 3 weeks on a peace ride with these people on a fundraising mission. Good people influencing me at a good time in my life, and I'm proud to be who I am almost 40 years later. And with my hemp consumption, yes, deliberately seeking, you know, what other so many benefits for all of humanity, and tonic food, no less, and super protein, by the way, John. We'll get into that. The Edistin, you know. Tonic is actually deliberately consumed by most for its side effects, which are freaking harmless.
Yeah, I don't get into the side effects. I just don't want those side effects. To me, they're negative side effects. But, you know, a lot of you guys that may talk crap about cannabis will just take regular medical drugs that have also, I would say, worse side effects that could cause your liver to go out on many drugs because there are literally toxins in your body. Mm-hmm. Cannabis, Josh, is it a toxin to our body?
No, not at all. You can kill yourself much easier with orange juice than cannabis. I mean, here's how, again, it's in the book, The Emperor Wears No Clothes. How the U.S. government in the 70s was desperate to prove that cannabis actually kills brain cells, which it absolutely categorically does not. The Gabriel Nahas, Dr. Nahas, N-A-H-A-S, the Nahas studies. Well, they took gas masks and just put cannabis smoke down them on these poor monkeys. Of course their brain cells died. They suffocated. And it's just nonsense, the propaganda that they manufactured and the willing public in those days. Now, what's interesting is post-30s, we had World War II, and suddenly hemp became the victory crop. And there's that famous propaganda video put out by the U.S. government practically begging U.S. former hemp farmers who'd had to have that tax put on them and say, oh, I'm not allowed to grow this no more. This is the evil crop. Suddenly, they're being begged to do it in 1942 for those same Navy ships. How ironic. Then the 50s came around, and of course, it's demonized ever since. I mean, I've always said Adolf Hitler's second greatest evil besides the killing of millions is the greedification of the oil culture, which pre-World War II was still not truly that dominant in society. Yes, the Rockefeller Forest, where our Humboldt property is, by the way. Even Rockefeller knew where paradise was. You got to come visit up in the Redwoods. So they didn't see the profits ratchet up until World War II. And on both sides. And we all know who really made money. Duh. You know, some people say it was the Bush family. They certainly come from that hierarchy, if you will, of, yeah, oil barons. Of course they made money off the Luftwaffe's air fuel consumption, too. The desperation that then went into all of corporate, at what point big oil truly took over at some point, I'd say middle of World War II, that, oh, this is all going to end in a year. How do we plan for this? Every G.I. Joe we've made money from, a Jeep being driven by, and a warship being piloted to, and an aircraft hopefully not crashing on, you know. How do we make money off it all? Well, we give them this place called suburbia. Blitzkrieg, invented for moving a tank's Autobahn, was originally for moving of entire armies, right? Oh, okay, now we make this thing called suburbia. And we give every serviceman now a car. Oh, and a pickup truck. And his wife need one too. And this thing, plastic. This little card that you make payments on. 80 years. how do we go back? How do we hempify ourselves? How do we de-plastify ourselves? That's the bigger picture. The fact that there's people still bickering, making negative comments on John Cola's channel about hemp is hilarious. This is 2022. World War III has actually begun, and it's a battle to save us from ourselves. And the right-wing preppers and the left-wing commune guys, all of us know. That's the truth. Politics be damned. This is the battle to save us from ourselves. And hemp is a big part of that victory. So help me God if it isn't. Go read the book, The Emperor Wears No Clothes. The benefits, which we could sit on this thing babbling for 2 hours together, John. It's no joke. For God's sakes, get off your little high horses and, you know, be happy that this is the Josh you know. And the John you know who tries not to get high. And you celebrate that you're doing things right. That you're part of the solution, not the problem. That it takes 10 carbon calories of fossil fuel energy for 1 calorie of supermarket food energy to exist in the society that we live in today. So you think it really matters in the big scheme that I'm riding my electric trikes around or driving an EV when I have to not live free or drive? Sticker on all my bikes. No. What matters is what you're doing. Turning suburbia back into an agri-hood. And that's the only hope we've got. And hemp's a big part of that.
Yeah.
No question.
Yep, I mean, yeah, you could eat hemp too. I mean, people eat the hemp seeds. You could go to your local health food store, get hemp seeds to eat, sprinkle them on your salad. You can get hemp butter these days, hemp oil, high omega-3 fatty acids. I mean, you could eat hemp leaves. They're completely edible. I eat them in salads, right, without the intoxicating effects.
Hemp seeds, like, pure superfood. You know, magical butter machine, set it on its cold setting, on its clean setting only. You're not making oil, cannabis oil, with the magical, go look it up, magical butter machine. Run it on its clean setting with pure water and hemp seeds. Run 3, 4, 5, 6 cycles. Be patient, 20 minutes. Throw some ice in there. There's no temperature increase when it does this. Does this amazing emulsification of them. Strain that off. You've got the finest colon rebuilding. You see these ads, they're on YouTube even. I've seen them, I think, on your channel of, oh, do you suffer ulcerative colitis? The Chemotocracy has another drug for you. You can rebuild that paper-thin wall, the human gut, with hemp, and only hemp that we know of contains this miraculous amino acid called edistin. Just go look it up. And that's the only amino acid that will literally rebuild that human gut. So you hear me always say, we're not what we eat, we're actually what we absorb. I mean, hemp is all about absorption. And then the protein in it is so complete, and I've never felt stronger than when I'm drinking those hemp milks. I gotta get back on those hemp milks, practice what I preach. Those things are, stock up on that, survival food. That and a cold setting only, it's not gonna consume any power. So if you're out there in the boonies on a 12-volt system, you got one of these magical butter machines, and you wanna make like a superfood on the go that would even, probably he would allow it, especially in a survival situation, not enough heat to violate that enzyme level. And oh my God, you know, strain that off and drink that. Whew. With some berries, I guarantee it. I talk a lot, I never talk poop. That hemp seed super milk. It can be obtained with, you know, a blender too, but you have to be much more careful about not overheating it. The fatty acids in hemp are so good for the human body. They happen to possess the perfect ratio of omega 9 to 6 to 3, much better than flaxseed or soy oils or any other oils. I mean, hemp is it. It's like the perfect human lubricant oil, but it should never be heated. Never be heated. Uh-uh. Never. The seed oil, flowers in some butters,
And then they have MCT. They have hemp protein powder, yeah. If you're like, want to bodybuild,
right,
get hemp protein.
You know what though, you don't need that.
You don't just eat the hemp seeds.
Yeah, look at this greenery getting in the camera. No, I mean, honestly, you don't need all that. You really don't.
Anyways, I guess the moral of this video for you guys that have been watching this for a while is to, guys, please do your own research. Don't just, you know, hear from somebody that cannabis is bad and then believe them. read the book Josh recommended to you guys.
Go put a link. Put a link. John.
I'll put a link down below in the description.
The big link right there. Right, make it stoner proof for them.
I'll put it in the description. You gotta read and that I'll book. I'll pin it to the comments.
The best information is free. You just gotta go get it.
Yeah. Go to scholar.google.com and search for the benefits of cannabis, like all the published studies on the benefits of hemp and cannabis to the human body are infinite. And that know that you do not have to get the intoxicating effects from it if you don't want to. And that's what I advocate. I advocate for the non-intoxicating effects. Of course, many of my viewers may love to get the intoxicating effects that, you know, what you guys do in your own home, you know, is up to you guys. I'm just going to share with you guys about this plant because to me it is another food. It's another amazing plant food. And whether you want to use it like I do, great. Whether you want to use it like Josh does, you know, that's up to you, right? Do what you guys want, but please, like, just, we got to stop the disinformation about it and just categorically saying this plant is bad, evil, the devil, or however you want to call it. Just like we need to categorically stop saying this group of people is this, or this group of people. That's all BS, man. We need to rise above. We need to have more tolerance of everything in the world because we're getting so intolerant, whether it's cannabis or anything else. And I think that's quite sad.
Sorry to interrupt, but I mean, in the 1980s, I could have a beer with my Republican neighbor on his front lawn as he worshipped Ronald Reagan, and we could agree to disagree. And he had my back and I had his. And he marveled at my bikes and, you know, whatever that version of the liberal lifestyle Josh pursued was. And we just, you know, we agreed to disagree, and we were stronger for it. And like I said, the French trust the people to squabble and sort their poop out. Now, hypothetically, this gentleman would, you know, be scheming possibly my demise, you know. And this is nonsense that we live in such an era with these trolls and the hatred getting spewed and how easy it is for people to pursue that and to conserve a true conservative. And I'm a pro-life liberal. I'll say it once again, you know, that's where I stand. And all life is very sacred. Soil is, you know, over oil, for God's sakes. That's kind of my angle with Boogie Brew, and you've heard me rant. And you know, I'm so ashamed that we and our parents, and that we allowed this plastification thing to happen. And hemp is, you know, one of the easy, quick fixes, you know, that people can really use right away, man. Start hempifying our whole. I'm about to release a hemp-based, soy-free Boogie Tea because we have customers who are soy-sensitive. And we've seen some soy crisis in our own supply chain because, of course, we only use the best non-GMO, down-to-earth certified organic. Well, guess what? When Trump put the tax on the non-American farmed soy, like basically on the soy we get, which by its very scarcity comes from Argentina, and now they're suddenly having to pay another 15% for this organic soy. The only soy I can get anywhere on the American continent, north or south, that isn't this horrific, what we all know to be most soy is today, you know, which is this GMO'd, you know, horror show. So I'm not going to go down that, but my point is we have experimented with, indeed, a hemp-powered version. And I think if we, you know, release a Caliwana Boogie Brew, you can see me, I'm a bit nervous now, having a chat with my self-esteem, trying to move our business to Humboldt, a hemp nation, and, you know, continue to produce Boogie Brew and explore this now. Okay, new product. It's time to release a new product, the hemp-powered variant. Walk that hemp talk, you know. Yeah, seriously, you know, with the hemp shirts we already don't sell right now on our website. They've been out of stock, but we'll have them again at some point. Anyways, you get it, you know. Basically, to me, it's hempify or die time, with or without 420 safety sessions on bike rides in between.
All right, yeah, and that's the reason why I'm making videos for you guys with people like TD and other growers, organic growers that I've visited in the past to teach you guys, if you guys want to grow cannabis for it, once again, it's non-intoxicating effects or it's intoxicating effects. I'm going to be there to share with you guys the full story, not just a stupid 5-minute clip, pour these chemotocracy chems on your cannabis and spray all these toxic, you know, non-food crop pesticides on it to kill the spider mites, right? which is what many people do in that industry, how to grow it the most sustainable way possible, growing the highest quality buds with lots of yield, because if you can only grow limited amounts of plants legally where you live, you know, I'm going to teach you guys how to do that, because it's an important crop of the future, in my opinion, for a food, for a medicine, for shelter, for many reasons. I mean, hemp for the future, I agree with Josh on this one for sure, and that's why I'm making these videos for you guys, so you guys can see how to do it if you guys want to learn the best practices, you know, from start to finish, because a lot of people might have a video on this or this, but I mean, I showed TD's whole progression, season one, and then now we're on season two, getting into more detail about things that you're not going to learn anywhere else.
I already cater to some of the best growers out there who elect to spend their hard-earned grow dollars on Boogie Brew, even though I beg them not to spend too much and do the workhorse variants. TD, they say, is the man. I mean, TD's 99 percentile, you know, and that is such a blessing. Here in suburbia, you know, here in the Bay, to discover such talent and to rebroadcast it to you all. And that's the only, yeah, because it is disgusting how the chemotocracy has indeed married itself to hemp horticulture now, whether it be through the medical scene for the last 25 years or now, you know, the big recreational super, you know, greenhouse mega facilities, you name it. With all the chemicals, and whether it was in these overpriced liquid variants or now the grow more dry plastic bags that you see leaving the grow store still to this day. And that is disgusting. Shame on us all that hemp was never valued like it was in the 80s and early 90s, when that was the only way you grew it. It was with compost, you know, and cow manure that was biodynamically whatever, you know. Seriously. You know, and no Boogie Brew either, you know, but the pre-compost tea, for God's sakes, let's get back to hemp sensibility time. You know, the way the Amish would do it, for God's sakes, the way our forefathers did it, without any deadrians. My God, how that got perverted. That's a whole nother video. We'll hit that on a different button.
All right, so I think that pretty much sums up this episode. If you guys enjoyed this episode, learning about my opinions on the hemp and the cannabis and proving you that I'm not a stoner, I mean, I could get my ex-girlfriends on here and friends that I hang out with all the time. They've never seen me,
never,
you know, toke up.
So one time that I have witnessed in 10 years, and now a second time I just learned about in this episode with this mysterious, what was it again? Avocados and artichoke
hearts
and raw bud
from one of my viewers. Oh, it was a pretty fatty. It was like this big, that tall, and it was like seriously that fat. It was a fatty bud.
And it was just raw.
No, just raw. Just ate it, you know,
with those foods.
Green. All, it was all green, just dried. Yeah.
And it definitely messed you up.
I was messed up on the plane, because I was halfway through the flight. I was good. Halfway through the flight, I'm like, oh shit, I'm feeling something. This is not cool. And I'm like, I just want this to be over with. I don't want to live in this body right now. It needs to just go away.
I would love for you to help me duplicate that recipe on the next time. When I go visit my parents, I take Amtrak. I take Amtrak from Jack London Square all the way to San Luis Obispo. It's a blissful journey. And of course, on Amtrak, you know, you can't go whipping out vaporizers at 420. So an edible thing, you know, like that sounds, you know, just because that sounds better than an Amtrak lunch. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So if you guys enjoyed this episode, want more episodes like this with a rant with Josh and I, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, be sure to like this video.
That helps out
the YouTube algorithm. Get this out to more people so that they can learn the truth about cannabis.
Add all your political bits about hemp.
Down below.
We want to see that. I want this board like so hemp populated like we've never seen before. Seriously.
Yeah. Let all the haters know how good it is. Yeah, I know a lot of you guys, all my viewers, probably know more about hemp than I do.
Exactly. And me too. You know, because I just read that one book, and then I got busy growing it, and, you know, now the tea the last 10 years, and I learned so much more from you all. I really do. So we value that. So please, post that.
Yep. Post it down below.
Your hempaganda. We want to hear it.
Wonderful. Yeah, if you guys enjoyed this episode and can't wait for the next video that I visit TD's, which is already filmed, make sure you click that subscribe button right down below. Make sure you click the bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. During the grow season for TD, I'll be putting out one video a month with him and his grow with the grow updates. So I don't want you guys to miss that. All those things that he modifies and does and changes up to make his grow even better. That's what you're going to see in his videos. And also, of course, you won't miss out on my other videos where I'm growing my vegetables, visiting places to grow vegetables, learning about the best soil amendments and organic, sprays and things to prevent bugs and pests in your garden that will work on cannabis, herbs, vegetables, or fruit crops, because that's what I'm about, edible crops. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,600 episodes at this time on this channel. Links down below to some of the videos I've done in the past with TD up to this point, all season one and season two, so you guys can get caught up to speed if you guys want to learn the best practices to grow cannabis outdoors, especially when you only are able to grow six plants like TD can. So with that, my name is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.